day of June 24, 1971, we are interviewing Mr. Don Fedderson from the Canadian County Historical Society, and it's located in the old Rock Island Depot. Don, give us some of your background, right up to now.
Well, James, I've lived in Canadian County most all my life, and all 41 years of it. And I grew up here and went to school in Union City, Oklahoma. Later moved to El Reno and finished my senior year. And that time I went on up to Stillwater and went to college there. And there was a few years I took out for one of the highlights of my life when I rodeoed for a living. And now I'm serving as a county commissioner in Canadian County and in District 2. Which I'm real contented at the time. I thoroughly enjoy my position here, and I feel like that I'm serving the finest people in the world in Canadian County.
Mr. Patterson, we understand you are quite a rodeo man. Would you give us or relate some of your history and the starting of rodeo and events?
Yes, James, it has been real rewarding to me, the professional rodeo life. It all started in Yukon, Oklahoma in 1949 when I got on my first bucking horse. Some old friends of mine that lived here for years and rodeoed by the name of Andy and Ed Curtis were there, and my brother was rodeoing at the time, and somehow or another they thought I ought to be a cowboy too, and they talked me into getting on this bronc, and I was fortunate enough to ride him. I don't know how. I didn't have any earthly idea what was going on, but they told me a few stories, and the Wild West stories, I guess, but I'd ridden all my life when I was growing up, the ranch life, and could ride a horse a little bit, but I never knew I could ride a bronc till that day at Yukon. And the first one I ever got on, I won fourth on him. And I guess that's the way it all started. And the next year, I went up to Oklahoma A&M College at the time, and that was the name of it. At that time, it changed to Oklahoma State University, and I started rodeoing in the college ranks. And it was real good to me, Jim. As I said, I started out in the saddle bronc riding, but I picked up the bareback riding, one of the major events, and also the steer wrestling, and or bulldogging, as it's called. And this was the event that's been the best to me since I started rodeoing in 1953 while I was in college. We made rodeos all over the United States at the college rodeos, and it was open to every college in the United States. And I was fortunate enough to win the bulldogging event, or steer wrestling as it's called, for the year, and which was quite an honor and something that anyone would like to do that ever participated in a rodeo is to be capable enough and fortunate enough to be a winner. So this kind of kicked me off, and after graduating from college in 1954, we moved up to Sydney, Nebraska in the oil field, and worked in the oil field and had a trucking operation running for a few years, and this time I went ahead and participated in what is now called the Rodeo Cowboy Association. They have 500 plus rodeos in the United States and Canada. And during this time from 54 to 59, in the 1956, 7, 8, 9 areas, we rodeoed throughout the United States and, as I said, Canada.
Give us your impression of your confidence in the professional cowboy rodeo association.
Well, James, I've met the finest people in the world, I think, in the rodeo business. It seems that ranch-type people are probably more honorable than some, I'd say, in some of the different walks of life. I think that there's more emphasis put on honesty and integrity. A man's word means so much more in this field, I think, than it does in some other fields that different people have been associated with. For instance, an old rancher might make a deal for $100,000 worth of cattle with a handshake, or $200,000, and three days later, a week later, they'll weigh the cattle, and this way it's handled. It just seems to me like that I've been fortunate enough to meet a lot of wonderful people and a lot of honest people.
Don, what have you won in the way of honors and achievements in the Rodeo Cowboy Association?
James, I've been fortunate enough to win a saddle or two and several belt buckles at the major rodeos in our country. I hate to brag on myself, but I won such rodeos as the Boston Garden in Boston, Massachusetts, and I won the Cow Palace in San Francisco on two different occasions, and won the granddaddy of them all, as it called, at Cheyenne, Wyoming. This is a few of my achievements in individual honors. And in 1959, I won fourth for the year in the Rodeo Cowboys Association in the steer wrestling. And the next year, I won second for the year, which was real good for me. There's several participants in each one of the individual events, and I was fortunate enough at the National Final Rodeo, which was the first year that year, to win second for the year. And
Don, what is information on the RCA Association? Can you bring us up and give us some information about this?
James, it was all formed in about 1936. They had what is known as the Turtles, which was a professional organization. And from the time of the rodeo first started back in the early 1900s at Pecos, Texas, and around some of these towns, when the ranchers get together on a Sunday afternoon, and maybe, I think, probably the first history record that was ever was at Pecos on the 4th of July. I know they're still having the rodeo there at Pecos, and it's one of the oldest ones in the world, and it all probably started right then, when these guys would get together and bet which one of the ranch hands could ride the best horse, and they started betting a little money on each side of the fence, and probably ended up in a fist fight, and it later came to pass that they needed some rules to govern the rodeo business. And in the 1920s, they started having these rodeos throughout the United States, and not too many, but they needed some rules to go by, and they formed what was known as the Turtles Association, and they got along pretty good. But as rodeos progressed and times moved on, why, in 1936, I believe it was, and back in New York and Boston, all the professional cowboys got together and formed an association which was the background of the old Turtles, and is now known as the Rodeo Cowboys Association. And since that day, I think we definitely progressed in a long way, because now in the United States we have 500 plus professional rodeos, and we do have offices in Denver, Colorado, and have a full staff governing these rodeos. And the main part of our rodeo business, I think, which has made it the success that it has, it's always been handled by the cowboys. The board of directors, which I happen to serve for 4 years as a still wrestling director, and was fortunate enough to serve on the board with these fine gentlemen, but they always had the background of a cowboy at heart, nothing else. They looked out for the livestock, but they were trying to improve the rodeo business and put it on a high enough standard and got rid of a lot of the old brawling and fighting and got a lot of what we think are some of the best people in the world. We got a lot of college athletes in the business, and they come along a long ways. And I know when they used to talk about rodeo and they told them about the ranch end, but now we've got so many athletes that it's kind of like a race at a, I might say kind of like a race that Jim Ryan had run in California. These guys train and they are professionals in this field. Board of directors consists of a man from each individual event, and also the president. They all have to be cowboys, James, and they've been able to govern this great organization to the place now where we think we have it on the highest standards of anything. We're real fond of it. And I know after serving as director, I did serve 4 years as vice president on this board. And we feel like we've made great strides in progressing the rodeo business, something that we've all loved from the day we were born, I guess. All ranch hands, I think, at some time or another would like to be a cowboy. It just seems like it. This is something that anybody would like to be.
Mr. Fedderson, will you give us the part about the RCA National Finals and the event winners for the year?
Yes, James, we're real proud of what we've accomplished in the rodeo business. In 1960, we had our first National Finals rodeo in Dallas, Texas, and what this is these guys rodeo all year long in their individual events. And I know the way it used to be when I first started rodeoing, they'd end up out in Arizona somewhere and be making a $50 or $100 rodeo and trying to pick up 10 or 12 more dollars to beat some other guy out in that special event for the year. And so we got together and thought what we really need to do was try to get the best saddle bronc and bareback horses and bulls in the world if we could. And we received cooperation from all the stock contractors and they, what is now known as the greatest match in the rodeo business is when these stock contractors pick their best stock in their strains and with their 30-some of them throughout the United States and Canada, and haul them all into where we now have our National Finals rodeo in Oklahoma City, which we've had there for the past 6 years, and are going to have it next year. Hopefully we're fortunate enough to have it the rest of our lives, but we'd kind of like to make it in Indianapolis or Kentucky Derby, but we have come a long ways, and I feel pretty assured that we will be able to keep it. But when they bring all these good broncs and bulls in here, and then they take the 15 top men in each event and match them together, you can't help but see the greatest rodeo in the world. And this is the part what we think that we've really accomplished something, because we have people coming from every state in the union that orders tickets, and also several different foreign countries every year are in attendance at our National Finals Rodeo. Our rodeo is held in December, this National Finals, and they've already sold several tickets as of June the 24th today for next year's rodeo. So there seems to be a great interest in this rodeo. One other thing I might mention that I've worked hand-in-hand with Senator Clem McSpadden. He is the manager of the National Finals, and I've been fortunate enough to get to work with him as his assistant and work closely with the Chamber of Commerce in Oklahoma City. And since this rodeo has been coming to Oklahoma, they figured it out, and they spend somewhere over $4 million a year in Oklahoma that hadn't been spent prior to the time the national finals come to Oklahoma City. So in my opinion, this is real good business for the state and also for the rodeo business. I know kind of like my wife, for instance, she takes people on tours to do the shopping prior to the Christmas vacation, and you know how those women are. They have a tendency to give her the money, and this just seems to be a good place to do it.
Don, how much money would a cowboy could make during the year at the all rodeo event?
Well, Larry Mahan, James, has been the man that's won the most money in the business. Prior to him, Buck Rutherford had won $44,000 for the year, and we have a young man in Oklahoma by the name of Jim Solis who's probably won the most money I know in Oklahoma and probably would be next to the great Bill Inman in last earnings, which would probably be somewhere around $500,000. Larry Mahan has won three consecutive years close to $50,000 in all of his events, which consists of the bareback riding, saddle bronc riding, and the bull riding. And he was fortunate enough to win, as I say, I know there was 2 years he won over $50,000, and 1 year he was right close to $50,000. So these guys move around and are able to make some money and do something that they love to do besides. And I'll say one thing, they certainly get to see the United States and Canada.
Don, do you have one horse in your life that has been good to you or maybe a little special?
I sure have, James. I've had several horses, but this one old horse that I'm going to tell you about goes by the name of Shorty. And old Shorty was born somewhere around 1949 or 50, and I got acquainted with him in 1952 when I was going to school up at Stillwater. Seeing this friend of mine and had a bronc on his hands, and he had bucked his hard man off 13 times, and the guy I'm telling you about is a guy named Lee Allred, a good friend of mine, had purchased this horse, and he was out of a racehorse by the name of Candy. And his mother was a real fine mare, but seemed like that they kind of spoiled him when they started and had a little trouble breaking him to ride. And so Lee made a deal with me, said, asked me if I would break this horse to ride. He just about killed him, and his cousin had been working for him, and he kind of thought maybe, being I'd rode some saddle broncs, that I might be able to hang him. And I told Lee that day, I said, well, Lee, I don't know whether there'd be none left the horse or not, but I believe I can break him to ride. And we were there at Stillwater in the arena, and I put my saddle on the old horse, and he bucked around there for about 30 minutes and reared up a few times, tried to throw me off. But in the meantime, I found out the horse had been rode quite a little, and he just real spoiled. And I think that one special day there at Stillwater, the old horse could have probably gone either way. He could have probably been one of the better bucking horses in the world, or else, as it turned out, he would have to be considered as one of the better bulldogging horses of the world. I know after I rode him around there, and he bucked for about 30 minutes or so, and he tried everywhere in the world to dust me. Well, I pulled my saddle off of him, and I went over and got my roping saddle, and Lee, he was astonished. He asked me what in the world I was going to do. Kind of, I think, with the look in his eye, I wondered if maybe I might be going out of my mind, but I put my roping saddle on the old horse, and they running some little old carries there, and Dice backed him in the box, and I run 14 carries on him that afternoon and roped 13 of them. So at the time, I thought the old horse certainly had a lot of potential, and so from that day on, why, I kept a roping on the old horse till had him broke good, and then we started bulldogging on him. And James, this horse, I might tell you, probably traveled somewhere over 150,000 miles in his life, and has made every rodeo, all the major rodeos in the United States. I know they've won such rodeos as New York, Madison Square Garden, and Cheyenne, Wyoming, and San Francisco, California, Fort Worth, Texas, San Antonio, Texas, and just rodeos all across the world that are too numerous to mention, but one of these feats that was Bill Lemon, probably one of the greatest cowboys that ever lived, won the bulldogging on him at Denver, Colorado one year. And the time I was able to participate, I know my own individual winnings off his back were somewhere around $50,000. And the riders that they kind of kept a loose record on it, but they won over $250,000, or $250,000 on this old horse. And I think if I or someone that hadn't participated in the rodeo business wouldn't have gotten a hold of this old horse at the time, we'd have probably ended up in Vine Sausage a long time ago, or been feeding a bunch of dogs somewhere, because he's just a little too rank for a lot of people to handle that weren't in the rodeo business. And now the old horse is out here on my place close to town, and last year we did take him to three rodeos, a friend of mine. The old horse still looks good. He's 21 or 2 years old, and we were able to win two of them on him. I know a friend of mine, the name of Jimmy Cubon, won Yukon on him last year, and we took him on over to Hinton, and neither one of us placed, but we hauled him down to Chickasaw, Oklahoma, and I was fortunate enough to win the bulldogging on him there. And just the other day, I went out and caught old Shorty and took him, saddled him up and took him down to ring and bulldog some steers on him. And if you didn't know him like I did, you'd think he's a colt. The old horse still has his individual composure, and he wore out 5 Hazen horses. Run every one of them, just outlived him and outlasted him. And it's probably the toughest horse that I know of in the world.
Don, did you care to predict the future of all three rodeo and cowboy rodeos in general?
James, I think every year our business has grown better. As I said, we probably started out with nothing, and now there's over $3 million added in professional rodeos in the United States. These 500 rodeos that I mentioned have over $3 million added money. And every year we pick up more rodeos, and the crowd seems to get better every year. So I can't help but think, as long as the American people, or the people as a whole throughout the world where these rodeos have been taken, are starved for entertainment. And it seems like they get pacified better in a rodeo than about any sporting event that they can go to. And it just seems to me like that we're in a $3 million bracket now, and I'd venture to say in 10 years this figure will probably be $6 or $7 million. And these contestants and participants are able to achieve higher goals every year in money won, and I think it won't be too far a distant future till one of these guys will make $100,000 for the year. And I know right now at our national finals rodeo that they are adding over $100,000 at this one individual rodeo. And Houston, Texas is adding somewhere around $80,000 or $90,000, and it just seems to me like it's growing by leaps and bounds, and people are kind of going back to the history and the old cowboys, and they do have a significance in our world, I think, James.
We have just completed a very fine interview with Mr. Don Fedderson, one of the cowboy greats of Oklahoma. Your interviewer has been James Katigan for the Living Legend Library of Oklahoma Christian College. We have made this interview today on June 24th, 1971, from the Canadian County Historical Society of Oklahoma at the Palomino, Oklahoma, which is a fine new library, historical society. All the events from way back here in this wonderful Canadian County Historical Society library. This is to help preserve Canadian County's great historical heritage.
Wait, now that other man's...